I listened to mowing the lawn, the top hits, like currently the top 50.
Right.
Did you listen to the Eminem thing?
I haven't listened to the Eminem album yet.
It's decent.
I heard it's decent.
I've been out of the game for a while.
You know what I kept hearing today? The Machine Gun Kelly like rip of Eminem. Have you heard that yet?
No, I didn't listen to it.
It's, I mean, I don't know how to feel about it.
Are we started?
It's live. Yeah. I mean, I didn't start the show yet.
The Tim Horner starting off. Okay. I didn't know we were on. All right.
Yeah, we're on there.
Cool.
You want to get on your phone for the comments, or do you want me to grab the computer real quick?
No. I'm so sorry.
Can you read that from there?
Sure.
What's it say?
WYO tonight, Nicholas.
It's hard. It's hard to read it from
there.
That's
all right. Just let's go. Nick Corliss is on. It's time to start.
Yeah. I just want to make sure we can read the comments because I can't read them from there.
I'll read them to you. I have my contacts in.
It says why tonight, Nicholas.
Start the show.
WYA tonight, Nicholas. That's Tim. Tim, we're in the official From the Hill studios here, buddy. And a little September song to start us off. What is up, everybody?
What's up, everybody? Welcome to September. Welcome to football season. We're back. It's From the Hill. We've been off for 2 weeks.
A little live From the Hill to get you started here with the football season kicking off. We got a lot to cover. We're not just going to talk football.
Yes, we are. Because it's football. It's football, baby.
That's all we're allowed to talk from here on out, right? Just football.
Football, baby. All weekend football.
It was a saturated football weekend, for sure.
It was, with a lot of crappy college games. Some good, some awful. But this weekend is the weekend that we get it all. Yeah. It all comes back. Everything falls back into place.
Yeah, NFL starts this weekend. College football started last weekend. We will get into that. So real quick, a couple housekeeping items to take care of. If you guys, well, first off, thanks everybody for coming out for the live show at the Whip Paint Tavern. It was a huge success. Really good time. Everybody that came out, I know, enjoyed their time there.
It was great. It was awesome. I was overwhelmed by how many people came out to the Whip Paint to support us and to learn a little bit more about sports.
Yeah, it was.
And maybe teach some of the hosts about sports.
And Nick was teaching everybody about Rampage and about Thurman Thomas. Yes. no, it was a great time. Thanks everybody for coming out. If you weren't able to get to that show, don't you worry. So we have two live shows lined up for Screwballs Sports Bar and Grill. That's in King of Prussia.
Right around the corner.
That's right. The first one is September 30th, and then the second one will be November 18th. So these are both 11 a.m. start times on Sunday. And the reason for that is they're both before Eagles away games. So we'll be going on at 11 o'clock. We'll run into the 12:30, 12:45 area, and then we will hang out for the Eagles game. So we invite everybody out to join us. We'll make sure we get that up on our social media platforms to remind everybody and get the invites out, but we expect to see everybody there for a good time.
Yep, definitely. We're gonna get things started for the game. So they're for the Eagles away games, obviously, and I'm very excited because it seems like the From the Hill brand is growing quickly, and it's thanks to you guys that show up and, you know, you come show your support, and people at the bar see that and they want to learn more about the show. So it's been great. Obviously, I know Jack wants to talk a little bit about how we've grown, and
Nick's getting his first straight man comment 4 minutes in because the brand is growing. As you can see here, we've got a couple sponsors. So I talked about Deer Valley Engravings before. Brad, my man, hooked us up with this cool growler here. So if you guys need anything engraved, hit us up. I can take care of you through Deer Valley Engravings. Also, you notice, yeah, you can check that out. It's pretty cool. You notice the M24 hat here. This hat is fire. I mean, I had people ask me about this before I told them I can get them. So obviously Dave Miller and the M24 gloves, also a partner of the show. If you guys need any gloves, any M24 apparel, right? It's all on his platforms. Just hit us up. We can take care of you if you don't have a direct connection to Dave. So we got that going on too. So we're really excited about all that stuff. And as a bonus, we've been talking about shirts for a while. Well, Swag's promise here is I will have the shirts by the September 30th show at Screwballs. So if you show up, you'll have a chance to get the first From the Hill t-shirts as well.
And we may have a merch booth set up, depending on who we can get to work the merch booth.
Put a truck out front in the parking lot.
Yeah, definitely. But yeah, so we're growing quickly. Jack has put a lot of time into this and got a lot of things going, a lot of money into it too. And you know, things are growing fast. We're really excited about it. And we hope that we can continue to come out and do these live shows because they're a lot of fun. And especially getting into football season now, these shows are going to be straight hot fire. They haven't been before, but it's going to be awesome. This is kind of the real first season that we're getting into From the Hill in football season. So last year we kind of jumped in the middle.
That's right. And that's a good point. And Nick, what else are we doing here for this football season?
Today?
Right. Yeah. In about what? 15 minutes?
In about 15 minutes, this is the first annual From the Hill Fantasy Football League that we threw together this afternoon, thanks to Ricky Lisey.
Yeah, big shout out to Ricky. He's the commish for the league, so we appreciate that a lot.
He put this all together. Thanks to everybody that jumped on my Facebook today and wanted to join. We have, I think we have 10 strong here.
10, we got 10.
You know, some people try to jump in at the last second, but it was just a little bit too late. Sorry about that, but we are going to be drafting live on the show today. So we're going to see how this goes, if we can kind of maintain our focus and stay on track and then still draft at the same time. I'm sure you guys are going to hear all about our picks and get some insight into how we run our fantasy teams.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting podcast here with the live draft starting in 17 minutes. So the one thing we sort of alluded to this before, one of the reasons we want to put this together is because we wanted to have a fun league. You know, the winner will take all. It'll be a decent little purse. But the real winner will be the 11 that don't – or the 10, 9 that don't finish in 10th, because the 10th place finisher is going to have to go through a punishment. We've sort of mused about this, and we'll put it out to the listeners. But we had a couple things to select from here, ideas that people thrown out. The first one was a From the Hill tattoo, which is a little aggressive and a little permanent, so I don't think that one will win. But the one that seems to be leading the charge right now is the loser has to do a From the Hill the body issue pose, as we see every year in the ESPN, the body issue. And that seems to be unanimous, the one to go with. So that probably is what we're going to go with. We'll let everybody vote on that. But, 10th place might be getting naked for a From the Hill.
Yeah, so if you guys have any comments, any ideas, if there's something that you've done in your league, post them in the comments here during the show. We're gonna kind of play with it a little bit, see where we go. We have some time to get it together. If we are doing the body issue, we have a couple months for me to get the six sculpted back up. So,
well, or just don't finish in last, right?
Well, you never know. I'm drafting seventh tonight, so we're going to see where it takes us. But yeah, it's pretty exciting.
All right, cool. Well, let's get into some content. And like I said, I wanted to cover a couple things before we got into football, because we're going to spend a lot of time in football, obviously. I want to start with golf. This is a really cool thing going on with golf right now. And I love how they've done this with the FedEx Cup, because once you get past the final major, right, like 10 years ago, there was not much left in golf besides the Ryder Cup, right?
Right.
But the FedEx Cup is awesome. And so now it gives guys something to play for. Like, it's like the fifth major winning the FedEx Championship before the Ryder Cup. So I think it's really, really cool. And the big highlight right now of the FedEx Cup, before we talk about this weekend's event, is the last two weekends. And I'll explain a little bit about how the FedEx Cup works so that if you guys don't follow it, you'll understand. But this guy, Bryson DeChambeau, has won the last two PGA Tour events, which were both cup events. Amazing. Did you catch any of Bryson?
Yeah, he's been coming up for a while, though, hasn't he?
He has.
He's a younger guy, though.
He is.
But I definitely heard his name going back to probably 5 years ago.
Yeah, well, so his story is he's a Tiger Woods guy. He's been practicing with Tiger. He was like a Tiger idol.
What does a Tiger Woods guy mean?
Well, so like he's been playing with Tiger. He's been playing practice rounds with Tiger. He's been practicing with Tiger. Right. He's like a Tiger disciple almost. It's like
now,
his protege.
Now, Tiger needs to get his own stuff together.
Well, he has his own stuff together.
I know.
Tiger's 25th in the FedEx Cup stands. He's playing well.
I get that. But, you know, 25th is 25th. That's not Tiger. Tiger's always been at the top of everything. So I don't know what a disciple of Tiger is and why he would be taking on, mentees at this point. But I think it's an interesting thing to keep people into it. The one thing that, you know, I'm not sure about is, do these guys really care about it?
I think they do a lot. I think it's important because, and I'll tell you why I do, because what happens is, so after this last event, now only the guys that are ranked in the top 70th get to come to right here in our backyard to play Aronimink this weekend.
Have you been there?
I have been there. Have you?
I have.
It's a beautiful course.
I was there for Tigers when they did the AT&T Championship here. I think I talked about it a couple of shows back. I was there for basically my birthday present was I got 7 or 5 days to go down there. And I went down there for the pro-am, the practice rounds. I went down there for every single day.
Yeah.
It was pretty awesome. And you don't know that there's a golf course back there. It's kind of like hidden. So I was there, and I was also at another one. What was the other one I was at? I was at the U.S. Open.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I preferred Aronimink.
So Aronimink, I've been on both courses too. I've never played. Don't get that twisted. But
heck.
Yeah, big time. Aronimink is really cool because of the first hole, right? First off, the clubhouse there is amazing. You walk through it, then they have the back deck, and that first hole, that tee box, sort of disappears into the fairway and then pops back up and around.
It goes down and up.
Yeah, and then pops around to the left. It's amazing. It's a beautiful view. The course is amazing, obviously, to be a PGA caliber course. But so there are only 70 guys playing this event this weekend, only the top 70 in the rankings currently. What was cool about watching the last round is some of the guys that were on the cusp as they were coming through the final round, the guy like made a putt for birdie and it had him projected 73. Then they real time updated it to 65. It was really cool. And I thought it was very progressive of golf to be doing something like that. Almost like if you watch a soccer match when they get the goal and they're like, okay, so-and-so projected to move on. It was really, really cool. I'm impressed.
And that's one of the good things with golf is that they actually realize that they need to be progressive and actually move things forward. And that's something that we've seen a lot of sports not even acknowledge. You know, we talk about baseball a lot and how the stats are going down. People are not watching baseball as much. And it's almost like baseball is not even paying attention to it. And they're just trying to, you know, brush it under the rug. Where golf, after Tiger kind of hit the decline, it went with it. The viewership went down with Tiger's decline. And it's good to see that they're at least trying to put new things in motion to see what sticks. Throw things at the wall. Like, see what happens, you know? And golf has seemed to do that. If the guys buy into it or not, that's another story. Is Bryson catch? Can somebody catch him right now?
So, dude, you're the best straight man in the business. So here's the way it works. So he won the last two events, right? And here's where your current rankings sit going into tomorrow's event. So Bryson DeChambeau is 1, Dustin Johnson's 2, Justin Rose 3, Tony Finau 4, Justin Thomas 5, Brooks Koepka 6, Bubba Watson 7, some other notables, Phil's at 9, and Tiger's at 25.
Okay.
So the most important part here is getting to the top 30 from tomorrow's event. So if you get to the top 30, then you get to play the last event of the year, which is the championship. And then here's where the question comes in. Well, let's say, what if Shambo goes on this amazing run and wins tomorrow, right? He would be uncatchable.
We're calling him Shambo?
Shambo. Shamboya.
All right.
He'd be uncatchable, right? But that's not how it works. Once they get to the final event, the last 30, they wipe the scoreboards and they reset the score by position. So it only gives the guy in first a little bit of a lead over everybody else. But even the guy in 30th, if he wins the event and the guy in first finishes lower than like, I think 10, can win it. So it's a really cool setup. So it gives everybody a chance of the 30 that makes the final match to win the title.
So everybody in that field is in contention.
Correct. Everybody in the field now is in contention.
And what do they win?
If you get to the top, it's like a major prize.
Like a championship
it's
belt?
It's a cup. Yeah, a strat.
Dude, that would be sweet.
Aaron Rodgers strat.
That would be sweet.
Should we get a From the Hill strat for the champ this year?
I think that's awesome.
There you go. We just came up with something live. We're getting a From the Hill strat. That'll be around my waist.
Rick, mark it. It is 8:49.
But we'll get a From the Hill strat for the winner. They should get a strat. What if they came to you and said, do you want this gigantic trophy or do you want a championship strat?
It's the belt, dude.
Yeah,
Who says the strap? It's the championship belt.
Who would take a trophy over a belt? Everybody has to take the belt, right?
You have to take the belt.
Yeah. Then you could do the rock and like hold it up with one arm.
And each year you add one of those little things down the side to the champ.
The notches. So you get to hold the belt for a year. Oh, yeah, actually, even like that better. Oh, that's definitely going to be for the fans.
Hey, do you still watch that?
What, pro wrestling?
Yeah.
Not really.
Do they still have that goofy belt?
They had
as the championship belt. It was the coolest thing ever. And then they went to this WWE belt and it like spun around and stuff like that.
Hang on. So, all right. So this is, I only know this from watching before and remembering. So here's the thing. They have the standard championship belt that if like a loser, like, I don't know, and who's a loser now, like Daniel Bryan or somebody wins it. But the WWE belt that spun was the John Cena special belt because it was a spinner inside
the dumbest
of the belt.
Thing ever.
Stone Cold had his own belt that had like the skulls on it.
I do remember that, but yeah. I don't like that. I don't like that at all.
They all get like it. So, and I think The Rock had his own custom belt. If you're like a big champion, you can get your own custom belt made.
Disagree.
Because I know Stone Cold had one. That's the Cena custom with the WWE thing that spins. That's not like everybody else's title.
Listen,
I still watch pro wrestling. I just know that.
I like Cena, but that's I strongly disagree with that.
Who has a strap?
Yeah, that's true. That's pretty funny.
A1 cordless.
That's pretty
good job, good. Nikki.
Yeah, I'm totally against the custom belt. One belt that I always wanted to win. Actually, I don't know more than the championship. Everybody wanted the Intercontinental belt.
Yeah.
And what the hell was it?
Dude, the Intercontinental Championship.
What does it even mean?
You used to be a big deal back in the day. Like Razor Ramon had it forever.
It was always like the A2 guy.
Yeah. The up and comers had it. So actually, speaking of like classic pro wrestling, not to digress, but the best match I ever watched in my life, and it's a classic match.
It's got to be Shawn Michaels has to be involved.
Of course, of course. The man, the myth, the legend himself was HBK against Razor Ramon for the Intercontinental title.
Man.
First ever ladder match. That match was amazing. I mean, I think I was like 12 or maybe younger, like 10. It was one of the best. It is the best wrestling match ever.
I think Shawn Michaels is probably in like 5 out of the best 10 matches ever.
Yeah, he is. He is. He's well regarded as one of the best wrestlers of all
this
time.
This took a hard turn.
It sure did. That's all right. We got to the championship.
This took a hard turn from golf to wrestling. Who would have thought it?
So that's it for golf. And if you guys have any questions about the golf stuff, I'm actually really into the FedEx Cup. So, you know, hit us up. Send messages in here. I'll answer them afterwards because I'm really into the FedEx Cup. I think it's cool. And anybody going to a Ronda Mink this weekend, you know, let us know if you're down there. Maybe you can get us some live footage. We'll cut it into the next show.
Get us a couple press passes.
Yeah, yeah. Hook us up. All right. So moving from golf and pro wrestling.
Somehow. Love it.
Let's do baseball because we're at that time of the year, Nick. Baseball is actually really important. And I don't want it to get totally overshadowed by football before we dive totally in. So we got a month left in the season here, and it's basically about 25 to 26 games, depending on, like, you know, where you're at in your schedule.
Yes.
And I wanted to run down the divisions and see who's up in the playoffs, see what's going on. So I wanted to start in the AL Central because, God, that division is horrendous, bro. Like, the Indians have a 15-game lead, and they're the only team over 500 in the division.
What else you got? They got the Tigers.
They're awful.
What else you have?
The Royals are pathetic.
Oh, man.
Yeah, it's a two. The White Sox stink.
Well, we knew,
terrible division.
Listen, we knew going into this that this was the most awful division in baseball because the Royals had started the decline from 2 years ago, and they're going into a really dark place right now as a franchise. It's, you know, I don't even know. I don't think they have anybody even coming up. I don't even know if they're rebuilding anything right now. So it's a really bad spot for them. White Sox, on the other hand, in my opinion, are the complete opposite. I think they've worked really hard to build up, to get their farm going. Now, whether they can develop it or not, that's another thing. And that's something that they struggled with in the past for sure. The Indians, we knew they were going to be there, right? We knew they were going to be one of the last teams standing in this whole thing, along with the Yankees, the Red Sox. It's weird because I really feel like that division is so stacked, and it usually is. Now that the Rays and the Orioles, they're turds, obviously. We always thought that the Blue Jays were going to be up there in the standings, and they've never really kind of turned the corner. So they're in a weird spot as well. But we could have predicted a lot of what went on in the American League.
I agree. And I mean, so you think about it, right? You're right about the Indians. And even though they're in a crap division, they're still a playoff World Series contending team, right? They have a great roster. So the Indians, obviously, just because they're in a crap division doesn't mean they're crap because they're not. The AL East, you just alluded to it. I mean, the Orioles are pathetic. They have 28 wins, dude, at this late
season.
Yeah, and they're pathetic.
And we talked a little bit about this a couple weeks ago and how the records of the Yankees and the Red Sox are kind of they're kind of inflated a little bit because of that,
yeah.
Because they get to play these guys so many times.
Yeah.
So there's that factor in. But the fact of the matter is that they are that much better than everyone in that division. It's not a fluke. They are a good team, but I'm saying their records may be just a little bit fatter because of who they're playing in that division so many times.
Yes, yes, I agree. And the Red Sox have come back to earth a little bit. This is a weird thing about baseball, right? Because I talked about this about a month ago with how the Red Sox were on, you know, close to a record setting pace like the Mariners were back in 2001. I think it was 2002. But all it takes in baseball is like a 2-8 skid, and all of a sudden you're like right back down to earth.
And they hit that skid. And
yep.
And for me, honestly, heading into the last month of the season, last few weeks of the season here, I like to see that skid. I like to see that because it's a wake-up call to yes. guys that,
yes.
you know, this is all it takes is a couple games and the season's
gone. And you're out
of
a series. Yeah, I agree with you. And even with that skid, they're still 10 games up on the Yanks. So I don't even think it's really even possible for the Yankees to catch them. But then moving out to the AL West to look at the rest of the playoff picture, you got the Astros in front of the A's there by 3 games. So that'll be a battle to the end, but it looks like...
Which is amazing that the A's...
The A's again,
the A's
dude.
Just hang around.
The A's again. By the way, best uniforms in baseball by far. Mm. My favorite are the A's. Like, oh. I know it's sacrilegious to wear, like, another team's uniform, but if there was a player on the A's I really, really liked, I would absolutely get an A's jersey.
All right, so listen. You have one opportunity to play for a team who's... You know, let's say, let's not count the Phillies in this. All right. So you get to play for a major league team. You get to put on a uniform of a major league team. You would put on the A's.
A's.
Nah.
A's.
I got to go Yankees all the way.
Ah, dude.
I really do.
That tired blue pinstripe, bro.
I
would take the Sox over the Yanks.
I can't imagine just like what it's like to put that uniform on and play in
the. All right. Well, you're asking me a different question.
Stop. You're going to make me tear up.
Yeah. No. You're asking me a different question, though, because, yeah, I mean, I would take playing for a prestigious franchise like playing for the Yankees over the A's, but. Pure jersey. I'm going A's, dude.
I disagree.
What about the Cardinals? It's baseball heaven, man.
No, that's lame.
But so it looks like those are going to be your 5 playoff teams. In terms of record, the Yanks are above the A's, but they'll both be in that wild card slot if the A's don't win the West.
Listen, the A's aren't going to do anything in the playoffs.
You don't think the A's can beat the Yankees in a 1-game playoff? I think they could.
I don't think they're going to do anything in the playoffs, to be honest. I really just don't see it happening. It's the same teams that we talked about heading into this thing. The Yankees, the Red Sox, the Astros, and the Indians. That's who's going
to
be around.
Yeah, the big four are there. The A's are sort of the new guys to the party. I'll tell you one thing. If the A's get that fifth slot and they play the Yanks, I'm going to be rooting for the A's the whole way.
Sure. I mean, that's fine. I get it. I totally get that. You don't like the juggernaut, but even though they haven't been the juggernaut for a while. But, you know,
yeah.
I get it.
I like the A's.
All right.
All right, cool. So let's go NL. Let's go NL. Run that
yes,
NL?
Yes, and everybody can jump on me if they want to about me predicting the Phillies to win the NL East.
Hang on,
okay,
we'll get there.
Everybody can jump on me for it, but guess what?
You get your chance.
I'm sticking to my guns.
All right, so I want to do the NL East last. So
all right, I'm sorry.
Give people time to put in the comments to come after you right now. That's a good
bring it.
Good lead on. So again, let's start out West. The West, actually, the NL is pretty open for a lot of slots right now. If you go out west, the Rockies, Dodgers, and D-backs are all separated by 1 game. So, and the Giants aren't too far out. I think they might be too far out to come back. But those three teams are clumped up there at the bottom. But their records, we probably won't see one of them get the wild card right now, depending on, because they're going to play each other, and they're all at about 77 wins. So moving to the Central, you've got a clump up there, not as tight, the Cubs and the Brewers and Cards. But the Brewers are leading the pack for that first wild card slot.
The Brewers are amazing.
The Brewers are playing really well.
And they got free players.
It's amazing.
They got some free players like Christian Yelich, who's now an MVP candidate, who's been on – he's leading the league in everything since the All-Star break. And you can't get him out right now. And they have Lorenzo Cain out there as well, who's doing really well. They look for real.
Yeah, they do look for real. And I talked about them a month ago running down the Cubbies, and they're still right behind them. The Cubs are playing really well. You know, pisses me off about the Cubs is Cole Hamels. Can we talk about Cole Hamels' record right now? 6-0 since he came over, just dominating for the Cubs, and that could be in Philly's red.
Well, when we talked about him being traded, we said when you get traded to a contender, it sparks it just reignites your passion to play the game. I mean, when you're on some dog team in the middle of July and they're not doing anything, what's your motivation to go out there and play and perform? And even if you do play and perform, there's nobody behind you doing the same thing. So when you get traded to somebody like a contender like the Cubs, who's always at the top of the list for NL teams that are going to be up there at the end of the year, then yeah, it reignites that fire in you. And I think we both thought Cole Hamels still had it, which is why we both wanted to get him back in Philly.
Oh, yeah. And we talk about when you talk about switching teams to a contender, you're talking about switching from the hitters league, the AL, to the pitchers league, the NL, right? So you got the double whammy there. And I just hate to see where the Phillies sit right now with the Cubs now and Cole pitching well for them. It just kills me. So speaking of that, we got, as Nick alluded to, the NL East. The Nationals still below 500. I can't wait till that team just blows up because I'm tired of them. And we talked about maybe Bryce Harper coming to the Phils. I'm sure that will ignite in the offseason. But right now, the Braves are up 2.5 on the Phillies, and the Phillies are losing to the Marlins right now.
Well, the Nationals are always everybody's favorite to win the division because they do have – it's just obvious how much talent they have there. They have the pitching. They have the hitting. They have the names. They have all that stuff. But then they have to trade a guy like Daniel Murphy that they sent over to the Cubs who is going to contribute there, obviously. What is this music on?
I just opened the app back
up. Okay. Right. I was wondering what that was. I know. But yeah, they have the Nationals always are that team that just can't get over the hump, and
they're about to crumble apart again. Though. You agree, right? Like that their core is about to shatter and they're about to go into the tank.
I don't know what the contract situation is with Scherzer and Strasburg because those are your main guys there. And those are the guys that are gonna bolster your pitching staff moving forward. But when Harper does move out, you know, is it going to be a good thing or a bad thing at this point? Like, can you say honestly right now that Harper leaving would necessarily be a bad thing? That the way that they haven't done anything over the last 5 years since he's been there, 6 years, 7 years, however long he seems like he's been in the league for 20 years at this point.
All right, so
he's 25 years old.
You make a good point because with a guy like Harper leaving, it frees up a lot of things.
Like,
but
listen, I'm not saying that getting rid of him is a good thing, and that's something I would do. If I was on the Nationals,
but I know what
I'm
you're
not
saying.
But you know, like, does it change the mindset of the team? Where
it does. Remember, I talk about this. It was the Boogie Cousins effect. For every team that Boogie Cousins was on for the last 3 years, when they moved him or he got hurt, the team played better. Sometimes that happens with a star on a team. But I just think the Nationals, once he's gone, Strasburg can't seem to stay healthy. I mean, that's the story of his career, right? And Scherzer's not getting any younger. So,
but Scherzer seems like he's going to go forever. He's one of those guys that pitches with fire.
Yeah,
like he goes out every day. He wants to kill you.
But doesn't he remind you of Roy Halladay? Like once he hits that wall, it could come at him fast, and that'd be it.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't remind me of Halladay because, you know, mechanics wise and the way his delivery,
That's a little bit.
But as he pitches more with emotion, like I think Halladay had more of a control over his emotion and the mentality of the game. I think Scherzer sometimes when he's going wrong gets in his own head, and you know you can see it spiral out of control quickly. But when he's on, you're not hitting him.
No,
you're just
well,
not hitting him.
And that I agree with you there. I was talking more about like the physical side because he's not a young guy, and we saw it with Halladay. Like he had his best season, and then all of a sudden it was gone. And once it was gone physically, that was it.
I think a little more power from Scherzer. You know, I think agree, he's more of
yeah,
a power guy
a little
than,
bit more.
Than Halladay.
But Halladay was a power guy. Especially in his younger days. But no, I agree with you.
So, you know, moving on to the Phillies, and I'm about to – this is where you're going to see the show start to chop up a little bit because we are live in our draft right now. Somebody is about to go on to the auto draft, which is going to get me fired up.
I just got auto drafted on my first round pick.
God, yeah. Come on, man. All right, so I get Alvin Kamara, Julio Jones.
I don't know who I got. I'm sure it was probably – yep, that's great. I got auto-drafted for that in the
all
third
right.
pick.
Hopefully we're playing PPR.
This is terrible.
I took Alvin Kamara. So you got to pay attention, Jack.
This is terrible. So, I'm trying to run a podcast here, God damn it.
All right, so listen. The way I see the Phillies playing out here, okay, I know that they're 3 games back. I know they're losing to crap teams like the Marlins. We have a shot moving forward because our schedule is not as strong as the Braves' schedule. So the key to that, obviously, is you have to win the games that you're supposed to win, like the Marlins. Nothing drives me more crazy when they lose. It seems like every time I watch them play the Marlins, they're losing to the Marlins.
They're losing to them right now.
So that's one thing that really drives me nuts. Who's pitching, Arrieta tonight? I think Arrieta's pitching
right.
tonight. But the good thing is, and this is good for us because I think, like I talked about, I think the Braves have a younger team. I don't think they're as developed as far as pitching and things like that. We play them
seven more times
this month.
Yep.
And I think, obviously, that's going to determine all of this stuff.
I agree with you. It's seven more times this month.
That's
and it's
why
four in Atlanta. That's going to be the big series.
That's why I'm still
on the road.
That's why I'm still optimistic here. Like baseball, like we talked about, is a season of ups and downs, and it goes from week to week. Day to day, not month to month. So you have a whole month of ups and downs to go. And just like we saw them come out hot and we didn't expect it from them to be in first place at a certain point, it was probably late probably late July, like to early August, maybe they were still in first place.
Yeah, they lost. They lost first place, basically like the day before we did the podcast at the Whip Pain, so like 2 weeks ago.
Right. So like we weren't expecting that, but you know, there's a whole month of ups and downs to go. So people overreact, and they want to fire Kapler, but you look at certain things that Kapler's doing, and you don't necessarily understand all of it, but he's trying to make something click. Like something has to click back into place that fell out of place. And I think the first place that you look for that is Odubel Herrera, who has been absolutely horrid over the last, how long? Since probably July, the beginning of July.
He's not been playing well. That's true.
So what do you do now? Because you have a guy like Roman Quinn, who is now playing extremely well. But you have Odubel Herrera, who was at the beginning of the year looking like your all-star. We were all upset that he didn't make the all-star team.
It's hard to sit him. I mean, he's probably your best player, your second best player overall. So it's hard to put him down. I just differ with your opinion on this. And I said it at our last podcast. I just don't think that they have enough offensively to do it. And so I don't agree with you. I don't think they'll make it down the stretch. I said the only way they were going to get it done, I knew that they already didn't hit well, and they still don't hit well, and they won't hit well. I didn't care about adding Ramos or
why?
Because I didn't think it would be enough. I didn't think that was enough. I think we had to pitch our way there. That was the basis of this team, and I thought without adding Cole or another quality starter, it wasn't going to happen, and I still don't think it is. I just don't think they hit well enough. They had that four-game series with the Braves at the end of the year in Atlanta, and they're not a great road team. And if they go down there and split when they're down two games, they're not going to do it. So, yeah, thanks. Thanks, Ricky. Thanks. Well, thanks for the notification now, Ricky, for my second pick since I got Le'Veon Bell first. Yeah, appreciate it.
Listen, you mentioned that their hitting's not good enough, but then you said, well, they should have went and got a pitcher. Like, it's one or the other. They get some bats now. I mean,
they got bats, but I said,
I know they got Batista. I said they weren't. He's like way on the decline. But he's actually somebody that brings a lot to the table as far as that he's just played recently for two NL East teams that could help them pick up wins in the next month. Like he talked about their team strategy and knowing a little bit more about those teams. Obviously, in baseball, those things change a lot, especially when you're playing against somebody that was just in your clubhouse a few weeks ago. But it's just one of those things that it's a new look for the guys, and it kind of reignites things. It's a veteran in the clubhouse that they really didn't have before. I mean, I can't think of anybody that's really a veteran presence in the clubhouse. Take that for what it's worth. But, you know, certain things in baseball sometimes can ignite a team. Even if it's for a week or two at a time at this point.
But that's what I'm saying, dude. Like, listen, I like Osdrubal. I liked getting Ramos and him coming back, and I don't mind.
Struble's not doing anything.
I don't mind but he's still a good offensive player. Like, I like the pickup, and I liked bringing Joey Bats in for nothing just to maybe ignite the spark. But I said this before, and I still stick by it. I don't think those moves were going to be enough, and they're not panning out to be. I like the bat ads. I like them, but we needed another pitcher to get us through the stretch. That's just me. We're not going to agree on this because you think they're going to pull it out in that. I don't, but I think that if we really wanted to make a press this year, it would have been with a veteran pitcher like Cole or Happ. I really wanted Cole. I would have been fine with Happ, but we didn't get either.
I was on board with both too, but you know, I did think that
and add the bats too. I mean,
it was important.
Think about it. We got Ramos for a player to be named later. We got bats after waivers for nothing. Like the bats that we added, we could have added anyway with picking up a guy like Cole. You know what I'm saying? Like they made those moves to add those guys without giving up anything anyway. I mean, Ramos was a throw-in. That was cash considerations, the old player name later. Joey Bats was a waiver claim, right, that we gave nothing up for. So we could have got these guys anyway and added the pitching. And the fact that we didn't add the pitching is what's getting us right now. Because, again, even adding those bats, it's not going to be enough of a spark to where this team's going to become a team that's going to generate enough offense to win.
Jack, you're on the clock. I think a lot of it is – there's some difficulty in the bullpen as well. And the bullpen has been very inconsistent. They've done really well at times, but other times they've completely taken us out of games that we stay in. And for some reason...
Wait a minute. I got to interject real quick. Sorry to cut you off. Who's the Bridgeport Dragons in our fantasy league? Out yourself right now.
That's Tim Horner.
That's a great team name. Tim, incredible. Good job, buddy.
So, they've been so inconsistent.
What's up, Eric?
I just got thrown off. I don't know what I was talking about. But they've been – the bullpen has been really inconsistent. And I think Gabe hasn't allowed guys to set into a spot to know when they have to perform or not. The other thing that I did want to talk about
– that's a problem with him. Isn't that a problem with him and that managing style?
I mean –
isn't it that you don't let the guys get set in their spot in the lineup? Isn't that a problem? Analytics tell you it's not. But as a baseball guy, isn't that a problem?
I don't know. I think at times that his unpredictability has become predictable. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
So that guys need to be ready at all times to go. And, you know, it's just a different thing about him that we're still kind of figuring him out a little bit. One of the things that always bothers me, and I've never understood this, and it seems like it's every single year, is that our best pitcher, never gets the support, the run support at all. And if we could get like 3 runs for Aaron Nola every game, we would probably have 7-8 more wins at this point.
Yeah,
because
agreed.
It seems like every time he's out there, he's in a fight against another
team's ace.
Yeah,
and we can't score for him. I know. Team can't hit, dude. Can't hit. All right, we'll see what happens with the Phils. We're going to keep doing the draft. We'll monitor the Phils game that's going on right now. Let's move into college football. You ready, Nikki?
I am. Who's talking on there?
Calling my receiver, bud.
Thanks, Eric.
All right.
You guys, I got Le'Veon Bell auto-picked for me in my first pick, and we're gonna talk about him when we get to NFL because that whole thing's baffling.
Right now,
that's going to suck for me.
Right now, I'm working with Alvin Kamara, Leonard Fournette, and Adam Thielen.
My team stinks already. I'm giving up. All right, so college football, week one was last week. We had some good matchups week one. It wasn't a banger, complete banger, that we've had some other seasons.
Well, let me ask you this.
We had some good matchups.
Let me ask you if you know the question on this, because I don't know the answer. Know the answer to this, I meant. How do they schedule these games?
That's a good question, actually. I know they're scheduled out a bunch of years in advance. The first one, right, the Michigan-Notre Dame game.
Because there's so many turd games the first game of the year.
Yeah.
And it almost seems like teams would want to set it up that way.
Yeah.
Look, like how does Washington and Auburn get the first game of the season? How does what's some of the good ones? LSU and Miami. How do they have that scheduled?
Notre
Dame, Michigan get scheduled in the first week of the season? I almost don't want to see those games the first week of the season. Like, I'm excited to watch them, but at the same time, I know that both of those teams aren't really in form yet.
Well, I think it's the philosophy of you want to strengthen your schedule by playing a good out of conference, right? Notre Dame doesn't have a conference, but for a lot of these other teams, by playing a good out-of-conference game, because you're only going to get 3 games before you get into conference for most conferences. And the philosophy is, even if you lose your first game, that doesn't necessarily keep you from getting in the playoffs.
But
it hurts.
It could, though.
It could.
It really could.
It could, for sure, but it doesn't necessarily do it. As a loss, the fifth or sixth game ends up being a lot worse than the first game.
Like let's look real quick at Washington and Auburn. Like, if Washington wins that game, Auburn's pretty much done, right?
No, I think it...
Because they're going to have a couple losses in their
right,
conference.
But they're in the SEC. I mean...
I know, but to make the playoffs, there's a bunch of teams in that conference that can come out and be in that playoff.
Yeah. I don't think losing your first game ever excludes you.
So you would have to be you would have to be the fourth man in.
You got to win out.
When you're already looking at... And let's be honest, there's nobody. I don't think there's anybody here that wouldn't take Alabama, Clemson, and Georgia to be in the top be in those playoffs.
But see, if
right?
you're Auburn, you already know you're going to have to beat both Georgia and Alabama, so you're going to get your shot. And if you can beat Bama and you have one loss, and Bama has one loss, you're ahead of them. So
I mean, but the odds of it happening is just like,
I mean, the odds of anybody beating Alabama,
you just really get off to a bad start if you lose that game.
But I like scheduling a tough game the first game. Like, I don't want to be Penn State scheduling App State, who, by the way, almost lost that game.
Yeah, well, Appalachian State always plays tough.
Sure, but they're D1 AA, or what do we call that this day? Football championship or something, right? Instead
I don't
know. It's at, like, they changed it from
Carson Wentz
one AAA to football bowl series, and then from one double A to football championship series. So they're like they're an FCS team, I think.
I really don't get it either, but it's also you can hype those games up a lot, but it's almost like what we saw from Florida State last year, where you think the team is more than they actually are, and then they show themselves a little bit more.
Brad's chiming in here. He says you really need to know your strengths and weaknesses the first week when you go out there. And I think that's to your point. You got to know what you have. You can't start slow because you could turn up with a loss right away.
Well, sure.
Yeah.
But that's what I'm saying is I don't know how the games get scheduled and why it would be beneficial before you know what you have to go out there and do that. That's all I'm saying.
I think on the reverse side, right, if you go out, it's a 50-50 shot. If you go out and win that first game, then you're in business. You just got a nice out-of-conference win against a ranked team to go into the season. You're in business. Like, you're in a driver's seat now. So it's a 50-50 prop. You know what I mean? That's how I've always looked at it.
I get it. I don't think I would take that route if I was in, you know, somebody scheduling that game. But
if you don't,
it certainly makes for a more exciting first week of football to jump right back into it. And there were some tough matchups.
If you don't take that, then what you deal with late in the season is you never played anybody. Right? You'll get, you never schedule anybody outside your conference. They sit at the Bama every year. Well, they didn't schedule anybody outside their conference, right? Like, Bama just beat Louisville. And last year with Lamar Jackson, like, then Louisville would have been something on the schedule. Right. But now it was, they pancaked them. And then it's, Alabama just coasts in every year, only going through the SEC and not playing anybody out of conference.
So I think the thing that we need to look at is how the games do get scheduled. Because if they schedule it recent and Auburn had Washington on the schedule first week, then that looks really good for them moving forward, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So I know the top three teams. I think I know right now who's going to be in the playoffs beside the fourth team. And I wanted to ask you, who's your fourth team in?
Well,
let me ask you, who's all your teams in?
Is
it the three that I said?
Of course. I mean, those three are your front runners. Oh God, it's so early, dude. I mean,
I know
you would have to think.
But everybody jumps to these conclusions after they see one game, right?
Right.
So why don't we just jump to conclusions?
Sure.
Why not?
So
that's what we do.
All right. So, and I would say I'm still going to count Ohio State in there out of the Big Ten.
That's my fourth.
Well, you have to think if two SEC teams make it again, right, and Clemson comes out of the ACC, then you've got two choices because the Pac-12 always stinks. So they're out. So you got the Big Ten or the Big 12. And there's nobody in the Big 12 that seriously impresses me this year right now. So then I have to go to the Big Ten. And with Penn State almost losing to App State, Michigan already has a loss. Ohio State's already in the driver's seat. And so you figure,
what about Wisconsin?
I was just going to say, because Wisconsin comes from the other side. That's the thing. And I actually wanted to break this down more since we talk about Michigan, right? Michigan lost to Notre Dame. Notre Dame front ran. They actually looked really good. But so Michigan loses. And then the questions all come up about Harbaugh, right? And, you know, what's going on? Cilio's chiming in, Ohio State. Yeah, we got a lot of Ohio State fans.
I'm not a fan.
Mazza is.
Listen, Torch Talk has made me an Ohio State fan.
You get misconstrued as an Ohio State fan.
Yeah, I do. But it's because they constantly are at the top of the list.
Cilio, you'll let Buha wear an Ohio State jersey, right? You guys would accept them in for some Ohio State red and what do they wear? Red, white, and silver? Red, white, and black?
Of course.
Go Buckeyes!
Cilio's my sunglass connect.
So what do you think about Harbaugh? Do you think that his tenure at Michigan hasn't been a success?
It's kind of still early to say because you have to give him some time to turn it around. And it's really – I really don't like when the coach becomes more of a character than he is a coach. So what do I mean by that? Nick Saban is the face of Alabama, right? But Nick Saban – he's not doing goofy stuff. He's not talked about constantly for making comments. He doesn't have the goofy glasses. He doesn't want to be the show. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
And I think that Harbaugh has a little bit of that in him, and I think that's why he's so overhyped. So, you know, if anybody else was the coach at Michigan right now, would Michigan be so overhyped? like they are this year.
So, all right. Actually, that's a good point. And I actually did want to bring this up. So here's the thing. I got to open that back up. So with Michigan, right, I think I missed the pick again. I got auto-picked. Whatever. My team stinks. I got Doug Baldwin. He's pretty good. Oh,
You're on the clock right now.
Oh, never mind.
Come on, man.
Hang on. So what I'm saying is I think a team like Michigan automatically has that hype with them because they're Michigan, right? And so Harbaugh being there, even with his antics, I don't think lessens or increases the expectations on Michigan. What I was going to say is, shouldn't you take a team like Michigan and sort of recalibrate your expectations for what that team can be? Because when you break down where a team sits, you have to think, if you're Michigan, you're in the Big Ten, right? And so you've always got Penn State and Ohio State in your conference on your side of the division. So you've got to beat them both every year. And then Michigan State sometimes, who's a rival, who's on your side. So for Michigan, like to me,
Michigan State has owned that in yeah, the last couple of years.
They have. And so for me, my expectations for Michigan would be not even trying to make the playoff, would be just focusing on trying to win your side of the division, right? Or beat your rivals. Because they're not, to me, as much as their fans think they are, they're not, to me, a perennial playoff contender.
No, it's not like the
whereas
2000s, 90s.
Exactly. Anyway. Whereas if you're Wisconsin, you get to be
you're on the clock.
You get to be a year-by-year constant perennial playoff contender because of the fact that you're on the other side. And so as long as you can take care of your business on the other side, you can get to the Big Ten championship game and then maybe have a shot at the playoff.
And you fly under the radar in a certain way. You know, it's not like everybody's not on the Wisconsin wagon right now. I mean, they are getting some hype.
For good reason, because of what we're saying, right? You think about it, they only have to beat Iowa every year and then the rest of the Big Ten West or whatever they call them. And then they get whoever comes out of Michigan State, Michigan, Penn State, and Ohio State beating each other up. And they have to just one game. And if they win that game and clean up the rest of their schedule, they're going to make the playoff. A no-loss Wisconsin team that wins the Big Ten championship is guaranteed to make the playoff. So that's where you can sort of recalibrate expectations. And the difference is what you were saying about like Harbaugh versus Saban, where Saban doesn't put the show on there. Saban runs a tight ship. I mean, you've heard him just lambasting the media about asking about his quarterback and how he runs everything.
Can we get into that a little bit?
Yeah.
So did you watch that?
Yeah, I did. So Tua is a stud.
Well, let's not even talk about the quarterback play yet.
You want to talk about Saban's comments?
Yeah, let's talk about what he said after the game. So yeah. for anybody that didn't see it, he was asked a question after the game. Now that you've gotten to see four quarters out of your quarterback in live action, you know, what have you learned? And which is a legitimate, fair question, is it not?
Yes.
I think it's a fair question because
it wasn't an unfair question at all.
We go into this thing knowing that there's going to be some kind of quarterback controversy. And that's obviously going to be the question until that first game is played, until you solidify and make a statement and make a decision like, hey, this is my quarterback. Until you do that, you're going to keep getting questions about it.
Yeah. So, listen, that people asking about this from day one, especially at the start of training camp, because he wouldn't name a starter, it's not out of line to ask the question. However, it's also not out of line for Nick Saban because he is Nick Saban. The power he wields, his resume allows it to say, you know what, piss off. I can do whatever I want. And if that includes vilifying you for asking me a question, I'm going to do it. Because he runs that town, he runs that city, he runs that state.
No, while you might not agree with it,
he can do whatever he wants, man.
It doesn't give
He's
you
just
a
coming
pass
off another national championship, like it's ho-hum. They're favored to win it again. He can do whatever he wants.
No, I don't think it gives you a pass to do that. I mean, if you're at work, you always have these annoyances, right, that you get ticked off about, and sometimes you want to say something, and you don't. You just can't do it. So it's not professional.
But
it's
Nick Saban is
– I get it.
He is the emperor. He's the president. He is the king.
But he is supposed to be the professional. He is supposed to be
– what he's supposed to do is win national championships, and that's what he's doing.
Right. But, you know, at the same time, there's people that need to know, that want to know about what he's thinking. What did he see out of his quarterbacks? It's been in the media since this season started. Was it going to be Tua or Jalen? Who is it going to be? He's going to make – and listen, I get it. You get annoyed and you get upset when people ask you the same questions over and over again. I get that, but you have to be able to just answer the question like a professional. That's all I think.
So So is being a beat writer for the Crimson Tide like the toughest job in college? Cilio chimes in because we're talking about Wisconsin, and he goes, yeah, how'd that work out for Wisconsin the last couple of years? Yeah, but the point is, see, right, they get there. So if you're as an Ohio State fan, right, playing on whatever they call their stupid divisions, like Freedom and Independence, whatever, what is this, Armageddon with the two ships, whatever they call their two divisions, I'm going to call them East and West. If Ohio State's coming out of the East consistently, all you got to do is Wisconsin is beat them. And I know that's easier said than done. But your biggest challenge on the other side is like Iowa, who, by the way, stomped a mud hole in Ohio State last year, if I remember correctly.
Stop. I'm not a fan, dude. I'm not even a fan of Ohio State. You just think I am.
I'm pandering to them sure more than you.
All right, so Tua versus Jalen. What do? You have the sound quarterback that will win you games and not turn the ball over, or you have the playmaker?
I mean, dude, I don't know how you don't play Tua. I mean, dude, he is electric. No? Watch him? I mean, not just the national championship. Like, he's the total package. He's like a mini Mike Vick.
But what's tough is Jalen doesn't turn the ball over.
No, he doesn't.
Where Tua can obviously go on, you know, he can have an off game and he can throw a couple punts.
Sure.
So that's what you're risking there.
Yeah, but for me personally, with the way the college game is played, I'm going Tua all day, because with the talent that Bama has, they can overcome even some of those turnovers, I feel like. But he can.
It really doesn't fit the Alabama
style. Tua is the most talented quarterback Alabama has had under the Saban regime. I don't think that's even like a question, right? I mean, look at the kid. Athletically, arm strength. Like, he's by far the most talented quarterback. And so the struggle then becomes, to your point, Nick doesn't really necessarily need that there, right? He just needs a quarterback who's going to, you know.
Right. Like, you know. Yeah. I get it. I get the allure of bringing him in there, because he is a dynamic player. But at the same time, turnovers are a big thing in college football. And the style of play that Alabama has for the last 10 years has been just don't turn the ball over. We're going to run the ball down your throat.
Yeah.
And we're going to play defense, and you're not going to score.
Yeah.
So that's kind of my take on it. I guess that's a bad take, because I would probably play Tua too.
Yeah. I mean, how can you not? When you see a kid like that with that type of talent, I just don't see how you can't play him. And I know you know what you're getting from Jalen, right?
There's no way he ever goes to the NFL with that throwing motion, right?
Who, Tua?
Yeah.
I think he'll get a look with his athleticism. I think he absolutely gets a look.
The way he throws that ball?
It's a big windup. But you know what's there? So he actually has a release very similar to everybody's favorite college quarterback, Tim Tebow. If you look at his throwing motion, it's very from the hip, wind up.
I was going to go Rivers.
Well, you're talking about his release point.
Yeah.
The release point doesn't bother me as much as the throwing motion does.
He's a little smaller, though, isn't he?
Than who, Rivers? Yeah, Rivers is tall.
Than
Tebow.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's a lot more. He's faster than Tim. He's, you know, Tim was big and athletic. Tebow, or Tua, is fast.
I get that, but we're talking NFL where you got to throw from the pocket. Look, you're not going to be running around playing Johnny Manziel football.
He's not going to go for 2 years. So, depending on what he develops into in college, I certainly give him a look.
You're going growth spurt. You're basing on growth spurt.
No, he can fill out a little bit.
No, I just don't see it. I just don't see it. But, you know, that's why I'm not an NFL scout.
The only other game I had of note on there, we talked about Penn State and App State, was LSU. Beat Miami.
If I can real quick go back to Michigan.
Sure.
So that's that. Like, the big thing there is quarterback play, right? Like,
yeah.
If they have a quarterback that's able to, I know Patterson coming down the stretch was like cramping up or whatever, but
yeah.
You know,
this was supposed to be the guy. So this is the thing about Harbaugh's tenure there. It's been, well, he hasn't gotten a quarterback that he wanted yet, right? But this was supposed to be his guy.
Yeah.
This is supposed to be his guy.
Yeah, so I think this year is the year where you see, you know, I'm not saying he gets canned, but it's hot seat time, right? Because this defense is supposed to be so good. It's supposed to be the best defense in the country, and that's all I've heard about is their defense and how good it's going to be. And, I mean, I don't know. We're going to have to see something. That's a tough loss right there to come back from.
Yeah. I mean, they have to run the table, which means they have to beat Ohio State, Penn State, and Michigan State. And he hasn't been able to do any of that. So.
And I honestly don't see it either.
No.
Because guess what? Ohio State has a quarterback now.
Yeah. Although Penn State doesn't look so good.
Well, I'm not going to judge them off of that. I'm not going to judge them off of that. Because number one, they did come back and win. So, you know, I don't necessarily care about winning by 60. They won in overtime against a team that always plays them tough, and it's the first game of the season. So, you know, you have to cut some leeway. But
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it was App State, though. And look, a win is a win.
See, we're both sitting here looking at our friends waiting to drive.
I know. This is what I was worried about. All right, so let's get off of college. Last thing I want to say of college was LSU beat Miami. So that's sort of a what are you looking at my draft here?
On the clock.
Yeah, I'm on the clock. LSU beat Miami. That was a tough loss for the U because the U was ranked up pretty high. They dropped down to like 22nd. But again, you look at those two teams, they're two perennial powerhouses or you know top 15 teams. So LSU now is in the driver's seat with a great win over Miami. And Miami has to come back. But that's why you schedule those games.
And again, now LSU has a quarterback and they look like they can jump up a little bit.
Yeah, because they've
been probably around what 15
something
now?
Like that. But they've been down the last couple of years in the SEC, so it's good to see them come back too.
There's a lot of good quarterbacks coming up, and Clemson's got the kid coming up as well that they're kind of between starting. It's kind of another quarterback controversy. The kid Lawrence, he's got the long hair. I think. Listen, if you can get yourself a nice Texas quarterback,
yeehaw!
You play the Texas quarterback
coming out of Texas.
Yeah,
because all Texas does make quarterbacks, boy.
I mean, I think you kind of are seeing like kind of a little bit of a turn in college football where it was never really about the quarterback. You of course you did have a lot of like five-star guys like Darnold comes out obviously, but no, this is now we're now getting to the point where like these kids are coming out and they can throw the ball now. It's oh, not yeah. just like it's a lot of run game. Don't get me. I'm not like saying the whole game's revolutionized, but the top teams now have guys that can sling it a little bit.
So actually, it's funny that you say that because what I heard a lot about the quarterbacks and sort of quarterback development from high school to college and college to NFL. And I think what we're seeing and what experts are telling me we're seeing as opposed to the way things have been in the past, the NFL game has implemented more college formations and college systems, right? Including RPOs, things like that. And high school has now evolved into more college schemes and systems. And so whereas it used to be such a huge jump at each level from high school to college and then college to NFL,
right.
It's getting closer. And so it's allowing these guys to have more of the development at each level, preparing for the next level. Yeah. So it's better for the quarterback play overall.
Is that to you, is that AAU culture where we're now, it's now not just coming in, you know, a few weeks before school starts and jumping into football as a high school student. Now it's like developmental camps and it's different types of coaching.
That's a good question.
At a much younger age, right?
Because right, they do all the summer, like 7-on-7s
right.
and stuff
so,
like that.
So, you know, when we were
it could high, it could be some of that.
When we were in high school, it's like, yeah, you show up in August, you go to camp, you know, and then you start the season. Now it's like you have kids that are, if they show an ounce of talent, they're going to these
right.
developmental camps. And there's like
right.
the AAU kind of factor where everything's year round, right?
Right.
Everybody's training year round to be the next Tiger Woods or the next Joe Montana or the next.
Yeah. So I do think it's some of that. I do think it's some of that. But I think the implementation of the RPO and more spread in NFL, which is like traditionally a college thing, and then them implementing more of that in high school because if like high school football was just traditionally mostly running and even more of a running quarterback and you barely threw.
Yeah, it's like the most you're going to throw is 10
exactly.
yards.
Exactly. So the implementation of even RPO there and more passing there has just closed the gap at both levels. And I think you're right. I mean, I watched in the summer like all the top high school prospects running like the 7-on-7 drills, you know, working out in shorts and stuff. So I agree there's more work there. But I do think it has a lot to do with the evolution of offenses in both high school and then NFL to implement that.
And you get yourself a damn Texas quarterback.
Well, yeah, I mean, I always want a Texas quarterback. Unless you get somebody from upstate PA, then you get yourself a Hall of Famer.
That's true.
So, yeah, let's move to the NFL because we've got opening night tomorrow night, don't we?
Yes, we do. It is an exciting time in the Philadelphia area. For the first time ever, the Eagles will be opening this season as defending Super Bowl champions in Philadelphia, Lincoln Financial Field against Matt Ryan, homeboy Matt Ryan and the Falcons. So what do you see this game working out to?
Well, let me tell you what I don't see and what I'm not worried about because the buildup here within the city has just been this concern about the Eagles and their preseason play. And you can take all that stuff and throw it out the window. I've been saying this for the last 5 years, especially even more so because of who our head coach is and the system that he came from, because this was always Andy Reid's philosophy, right? I don't care about preseason. it's not just the players in preseason. It's the fact that they don't show you any schemes. They don't show you any packages. They don't do anything, right? Preseason under an Andy Reid regime and now his protege Doug Peterson is a little bit of warm up for the guys, a little bit of get loose for the guys, and that's it. And then they're done. And so I don't care that they didn't look well and that Nick Foles didn't play well, because Doug's going to scheme a game and they're going to use protections and they're going to do different things the way they do to protect their guys. So screw the preseason. Like, I think the Eagles are now falling a little more under the radar for this season, and the bets in the to win the Super Bowl have shown it, that because they haven't performed well in the preseason, like, everybody's fallen off that bandwagon, and that's just stupid. They're still an ultra-talented team. Foles can still run the offense for a game or two until Wentz gets back. I see no reason why the Eagles should fall off whatsoever. Sorry, I was a little long-winded.
No, that's good. That's good, because I was looking at my team here. I just drafted Cam Newton. Thank you very much. So one of the things that you didn't mention in the rant there was that the Eagles' defense in the preseason has looked very good. It has looked like a top five defense.
Yeah. Yeah, it has.
And the important thing about that for tomorrow night is Jim Schwartz, for whatever reason, seems to have Matt Ryan and the Falcons' number, where they can't get him. They can't get Jim Schwartz, and we saw it in the playoff game last year, where they held them to what was it 10 points?
I think that's what
it
wound up being.
15-10.
I think it's what it wound up being. Yeah.
So I think that's one of the factors. The other thing is Matt Ryan. I don't think he's ever played well at Lincoln Financial Field, from what I've heard. I haven't looked up the stats on that, but I really don't think that he's come home here and played very well.
He's a hometown boy.
Yes, he went to Penn Charter.
Exton.
So,
Westchester.
Those are two other factors that you didn't mention, that the Eagles' defense is that good this year. And they're probably going to be even better because there's less question marks in the secondary, I think, to start the season. So that's the important thing for me. I know the Falcons have a high-powered offense, but for whatever reason, Schwartz has been able to shut it down. And I have no reason to say that I'm not confident he won't do it again. So that, and what you said about Doug's schemes and how Nick Foles is a different quarterback, Doug understands it, Doug realizes it, and changes up the entire offensive system. And that's what we saw for the last six games of the year last year.
Yep.
And I just can't doubt them at this point. It would be stupid for me to do that.
Yeah, I agree. I mean,
because guess what? Since they left LA last year, I doubted them every single game. Every single game, I thought that the sky was going to fall.
Yep.
And it just never did. So, you know what? You've earned that from me, Doug. I appreciate it. Make me proud.
Yeah, I agree with everything you said. And I mean, look, they're at home. They're going to be celebrating the Super Bowl win. The only thing that I get slightly concerned about with that is just, like, make sure you stay hungry, right?
Well, these guys, yeah, but we've heard over the past week that these guys want the banners taken out of the locker rooms. They don't want to be reminded of the past. They want to look at this season as a fresh season. Jay Wright was on the radio today, and he said, you know, we try to eliminate the word repeat from our memories. We try not to use the word repeat, because it's not repeat. It's, we have a whole fresh new season here. This is not the past. We're not living from last year. We need to take the same approach this year as we did at the beginning of last year. And this is coming from the players in the locker room, from what I've heard. Malcolm Jenkins in particular is trying to get rid of the banners and stuff. Like, stop. Don't pat yourself on the back. Don't pat yourself on the back, because we've seen how that happens.
Right.
It's really hard to, I'm going to say the word, repeat. But, you know, you have to win one to get on the path to repeat. So I like what I've seen so far in the defense, especially. I'm not as worried about the offense. There was a lot of things getting worked out as far as the line and things like that. Jason Peters hasn't played at all.
Well, that's the big thing on the line. Ricky Lizey chimed and said he's going down there. That's our commish, Ricky. It's good to see you going down to the game tomorrow. Yeah, I agree. And look, Big V's been playing. And as much as people want to vilify Big V for his play here in the preseason, Big V filled in really solid last year for Peters when he was out. So I don't think Big V's a scrub. I mean, he's not Jason Peters. He's a Hall of Famer. But, dude, I'm not worried about this team. It's at home. I didn't even check the line. I don't like to bet Eagles games. I'm assuming they're probably about a 3-point favorite. But, yeah, I have – my confidence is still there with the Eagles. Can we talk about the Khalil Mack trade? Because this is a big, big, big deal.
Please explain it to the listeners that live under the rocks.
This blew my mind. So Khalil Mack, for those of you who don't know, is probably the second best defensive player in the NFL, outside linebacker for the Raiders.
Are you saying Aaron Donald's the first?
Probably. Yeah, I would say probably, but they're comparable, right?
All right, sorry, threw you off.
No, you're fine. Curious. Aaron Donald just signed his deal finally with the Rams too, by the way, so he's in.
Yes.
But Khalil Mack gets traded to the Bears. And here's the deal. With him goes a 2020 second and a conditional fifth round pick from the Raiders with Khalil Mack to the Bears. That's what the Bears get. The Raiders get two first round picks this year and next year, a third in 2020, and a sixth next year. Now, let that breathe for a little bit. And he promptly signed a contract with extension with the Bears that put him above what Aaron Donald signed the day before. So they both signed huge deals. But Khalil Mack is now a Bear for the next 5 years. And I got to just take a look at this from the Raiders' perspective and go, what are you thinking? Like, okay, I get that the Bears aren't great. But even if one of them's a top 10 pick, I'm pretty sure Khalil Mack was like a fourth or fifth overall pick, if I'm not mistaken. And he played.
I think he was fifth
and
out of Buffalo.
He lived up to that, too.
Right.
So, like, you have to hope that one of those picks can turn into him. Like, why are you not signing him? I don't. What happened here? What behind the scenes happened that made this rift that he had to get traded? And I know, before I turn it over to you, that him and Gruden got into some things, let's call them, right? They didn't agree, and they started getting into some heat. But that's sort of the extent of it to me. I don't know what really happened here. I don't know your thoughts on it.
I think I could give you a little bit of insight based on what I heard prior to this even going down. So I'm about to pick here, but I did hear last week on Russillo. Ryan Russillo has the podcast. He's one of the guys that I listen to a lot because he just – all he does is read about sports, and he knows a lot about college football. He knows a lot about NFL football. He gets a lot into the NBA. He's just a guy that like kind of lives the whole thing.
You know how much respect I have for Russillo. So, Russillo's my guy.
Listen, the way he started his podcast, he's been a little bit about himself recently with the signing with the ESPN, signing with the Ringer, and things
like that.
That was
awesome.
Like, just a little too into himself lately.
That's right, my alley.
Listen, I do really, he is. But I do really like him. I do really like him, and he had on Chris Mortensen last week, and this was before the trade went down. Mortensen, from I don't know if he's heard it from sources or how he knows this, but the Raiders are a very cash poor team.
Yet they gave John Gruden 10 years, $100 million.
They did. So they signed on for that, thinking that they did have Mac under contract. So what they didn't want to do was have to sign him and basically send all this money, which it would go into this escrow account. It would be for like $70 million or whatever it
was. Yeah.
So it makes sense to me for a team that's been as poorly run over the last 20 years.
Sure.
20 years? 15 years?
At least 15, yes. At least 15 years.
So
poorly run.
It kind of makes some sense to me. Because they play in that dump stadium still, right?
Yeah,
because
they don't move to Vegas for 2 years?
I mean, it just, to me, it makes sense where Davis did not want to send that money away, or they didn't have it to give.
Right. I think I agree with you. It ends up being 100% financial. And because the flip side of that, right, is...
Like, I'm thinking of this. I'm like, how... Because we have this perception in our head that these guys sit on thrones, and they probably do have billions and billions of dollars. Yes, they probably do. I get all that. It's the NFL. They own an NFL team, but at the same time, you can be overextended
sure.
as an NFL owner and not even have the liquid assets to put into an account.
Still, even though it's the NFL, you still have the haves and have nots, right? Like the Cowboys, there's a big difference between the Cowboys and the Jaguars, right? Like, you still have the haves and have-nots. And the Raiders obviously are one of the have-nots given the fact that they're relocating cities, right? Like, we've known that about them. And so the other side, to your point about the financial side of it and them just not having the capital, also becomes when you lock up a player, when you lock up a certain amount of your salary to one player, right, there's a lot of statistical analysis around this on the quarterback position, but it also plays to other positions. And the Raiders aren't really ready to win a Super Bowl now. And so if they go lock up that money with Khalil Mack, that really hurts them for bolstering their roster to get there. And so what they're doing by getting these young draft picks back is now you're giving yourself a chance to go ahead and, okay, well, we can bolster our roster with draft picks who cost less and we'll still get good value back for Mack now rather than let him play out the year and then get less. So I see it from the Raiders side, but I just hate when you give up a player that like of his caliber.
Yeah,
for draft picks, because we know how first-round draft picks come back. Like, they're not going to get a player back even close to his caliber from one of those two picks, not even close.
Well, we can't say that.
I can say that.
We can't say that. But,
I put my stamp on it right now.
You know, some teams make the decision, just like Green Bay did with Aaron Rodgers, to put themselves in salary cap hell, right?
Yeah.
And that's what ends up kind of crushing your franchise. So was it this part of a decision to do that? I don't know enough about the salary cap and how much the Raiders are paying other players on the. I don't know. I don't have that information. But it seems like if you're gonna do that, it would be for the quarterback position, a more important position than your linebacker position,
right?
An edge rusher,
right? And I think that's where the Raiders are erring right now, right? And because the flip side of that. Right, what gives the Eagles the ability to say give that money to Fletcher Cox like they did, or the Rams to give that money to Aaron Donald, is because they both, the Eagles and the Rams, have young quarterbacks who are still on their rookie deals. So you can give those deals now, knowing you don't have to pay your quarterback for the next 3 or 4 years. And actually, there's a big movement in the NFL towards trying to win with those quarterbacks like Goff, like Wentz, who are under those deals, because of the fact that then you can extend at other positions.
You kind of have more urgency to start building your team.
Correct.
while they're under
that first contract, because sure. You can overextend at other positions, right, to fill in more money there. And then by the time they mature to their first deal, those other players are going to be on their way out or move on. That's sort of like the cycle philosophy of the NFL GM these days. So I get it from that standpoint. It just sort of blows my mind. The last thing I wanted to talk about player-wise was Le'Veon Bell, dude.
He's killing me. I took him second. Yeah. I know. I hate talking like fantasy football teams, like your own personal fantasy football teams.
As we're drafting one right now.
Yeah, I know. We are drafting, but I really just don't like doing that. But he is going to kill me because I think he kills everybody that had the second pick this year, because he's going to end up sitting down for Lord knows how long. What do you think? Is this a selfish move on his part, or is this a smart move on his part?
You can't say it's selfish, right? We can't say that it's selfish solely because of the fact that these guys don't get guaranteed money, and he's a running back, and this is probably the last big contract he gets. So I'm not going to sit here by any stretch and say that this is selfish. Now, the thing that sort of boggles my mind about him is they did offer him a big deal. It wasn't the guaranteed money that he wanted, but the rest of the money was there, and he turned it down. So now they slap him with franchise again, and he's refusing to show up, and I don't really get what his end game is here. Is he going to sit the whole season out? He's going to be 30. Like, on the one hand, I side with the player, because the money's not guaranteed, the position he plays, the performance that he's put up for that team. But then again, they offered him a really good deal. And because it was off by, like, I think $5 or $8 million of what he wanted guaranteed, he turned it down. And now he's in this weird situation. This situation to me.
I think he's really trying to make them feel the impact. I mean, that's what he's trying to do because of his diverse skill set and what he does out of the backfield and in the passing game. I think he opens that whole field up for him, so it's not all eyes on Antonio all the time.
Sure.
But, you know, he's trying to force their hand. For Tomlin to come out and say, well, I feel very confident I've got James Conner, is like, dude, seriously? You do have the best 1-2. You know, him and Gurley are 1A, 1B. You do have the best back in the league, and I think he's really trying to make them feel the squeeze so that when they go into this first game on Sunday – and they don't have him. Now, granted, it's against the Browns. But the Browns are a different team than they were last year.
The Browns still stink. Ryan chimes in. He just sort of mirrored what I said about giving one guy that mega deal and then it choking the rest of your roster.
Right.
But, I mean, honestly, with Le'Veon Bell in this situation here, I sort of agree with you to a sense, right? Because if they have to play the first week without him, that's going to suck. But at the same time, they are already dug in. They're, if you think they come out the first week and lose to the Browns, they're going to be like, oh, Le'Veon, we're going to give you what you want. I think they're already dug in, man. Like, they're not going to give him the deal. They've already decided that this is that was the best they're going to offer, and this is it. So now what's his end game? Does he take his franchise tender and play the year out, or does he sit the whole year out? Like, he's really drawing a line in the sand for himself because the Steelers have already said
– you don't want to come back with your tail between your legs.
Exactly.
Say, okay, fine.
Right, and the Steelers are already – the Steelers are not going to fold at this point. They're probably preparing to play the entire season without him.
Well, I think that's going to be a tough run for him because they haven't been able to get over the hump with him.
So Brad's asking, this is the second year for him, Brad. You're not allowed to do a three-year franchise tag. You can do two, and it increases each year that you do. If he shows up, his tender right now is for a little under $12 million, which obviously is incredible, right? And the deal that they offered him was a five-year, $70 million deal. I think it had around $20 to $25 million guaranteed, but you have to look at the disparity there from the max amount of the deal. Sorry, what did I say? Disparity? That's
all right.
G in there.
That's okay.
The max amount of the deal versus the guaranteed money is leaving that $50 million there at risk between the top end and the guaranteed for them to chop him at year three or four to minimal cap hit and then him miss the rest of that money. So he really wanted somewhere in the range, I think, of 30 to 35 guaranteed to make sure he was going to get that, and they wouldn't budge on the guaranteed money, and he turned down that offer, and then that's when they go, okay, well, franchise, and then now here we are.
So you think he's going to sit the whole year?
Well, here's the problem with that. To Brad's point, his question, if he doesn't tender the franchise this year, they can fucking do it to him again.
If he doesn't
tender it this year and sign it and show up, then they have another year of eligibility to franchise him again. And then what? Now he lost a whole year of football? Like, they have him by the acorns, right? Like,
the short and curlies.
So I'm fascinated to see how this works out. This is like the deep dirty of NFL contracting and negotiating 101, but it's going to get nasty. And I don't know.
So he's sitting there like, I hope they lose to the Browns.
Yes. He's sitting there like, I hope they lose.
They lose to the Browns.
Yeah. But again, I just don't see the Steelers coming back and being like, okay, we'll go back to that five-year deal and we'll give you the 35 mil guarantee just because they start 0-2. Because at that point, they're going to be like, all right, screw it. I don't know. This is so fascinating to me, the power dynamic. Like, we were talking about the leverage with trades, right? Like the NBA guys, we're in this spot where, like, I feel like the players, even when they do the holdouts, they just, like, their play, they just don't have enough behind the meat of them to not showing up to play with their collective bargaining versus like the NBA's, to where they don't hold enough to like get the team. The team wins.
It needs to be looked at in the bargaining agreement next time it comes around. I don't know when that is.
That's been the talk, actually. I think it's 2020 or 2021 or something like that. But yeah, that's been the talk. Like, this needs to get addressed, you know?
Absolutely.
And that really comes back to, and this is the last thing we'll say about it before we close up and take any questions, is it's sort of an oxymoron, because the reason football has such a nice parity year over year and the cycle is because of the lack of guaranteed contracts, right? And the reason basketball and baseball get so flooded that way is because the guaranteed contracts and guys get locked up, right? And so while we're both pro player, I'm pretty sure, and we like the guaranteed money,
we like the guys to get paid.
No, agreed. Because the flip side of that is when guys get paid, then that screws up a franchise and guys get overpaid and they get fat and inflated and right, it clogs up the league. And so you always go back and forth on this scale. Like, are we pro player and we want them to get all their money, or are we pro, you know, owners essentially, and we want them to be able to have that flexibility to cut guys and move guys so that we can keep the leagues healthy? And that's always the line that you walk. And the NFL seems to do a better job of staying on the non-side, whereas the NBA and baseball are already like sewn in, right? They're guaranteed contracts.
Yeah, and the baseball side of things is a little bit different. So yeah, these contracts are guaranteed and they can give you as much money as they want, but then teams like the Yankees are able to do that and avoid the downfall that comes from it. So when they do pay the superstar who was a superstar in 2012, and now it's 2016 and the guy's still getting paid $20 million a year, $30 million a year, whatever it is, they can afford to just look past that, pay the guy, continue paying whoever else they want, where other teams obviously can't do that. And that's one of the big differences in sports is, you know, when you're hamstrung in the other sports, you're hamstrung.
Oh, yeah.
Like, because there's a cap there and there's so much that goes into it that it does need to be looked at in the CBA as far as these franchise tags and guys getting tied
you're
up.
On the clock, buddy.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, no, I agree. And it's just so hard, like, the economics there and the negotiations because of past negotiations and things are so dug in. It's really difficult, but it's the most interesting part of the leagues in the economic side. So, it's pretty interesting stuff, but that's pretty much all I got for today. Nikki, you got anything else for us?
I don't. Appreciate you guys joining us. This is the first annual draft. We'll post the picks. Maybe we'll post teams. Maybe we'll show the folks what we got while we're sitting here talking and drafting at the same time. It was kind of difficult. You missed one, but you still got the number two overall pick.
Well, I was third, and I got Le'Veon Bell third because I
went second.
The first Antonio? Round pick. I'm assuming it was Gurley and probably. I don't know if AB was there or not. Ask Ricky.
We had to if he was a two, but yeah. Thanks guys for joining us again. Deer Valley Engraving, M24 batting gloves. What else we got, Jack? We got some swag coming up.
Swag's coming
show,
up.
Our show.
T-shirts are coming in. Obviously, still have the hats. I have these patches right here. If you guys are interested, all the swag that you see, you can get. Some of it you have to buy. Some of it you don't. Just hit me up. But remember, guys, we talked about the live shows, but you guys are what are keeping us going. It's your support. And the best way to support us is to share the videos, right? Is to go to our platforms on YouTube and on the iTunes podcast application. Click that like button. Give us a thumbs up. Click that subscribe button. That's what supports us the most. That and you guys getting on here commenting. We love every single one of you guys and girls that jumps on. That's it.
Come see us. Screwballs.
September 30th for the prof. Swag out. All your friends say you ain't really in love with him. Started off the hand and now I'm off the throne. Had to switch it up, I had to hit your phone. Can you picture us posted on the